that hurts. I want to spend my life mending broken people. I want to spend my life mending broken people.
Hello and welcome to 3ABN Today. My name is C.A. Murray, and allow me once again to thank you for sharing just a little of your no doubt busy day with us. To thank you as always for your love, your prayers, your support of Three Angels Broadcasting Network, as together we join hands with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to warn the world that Christ is coming very, very soon and that each of us must be ready for that grand and glorious day. I'm excited, yay, verily, today for a couple of reasons. One, subject matter. This is a ministry that we've sort of kept an eye on over the years, and it has, I don't want to say morphed as much as it has evolved and changed its direction just a little bit and grown. And then I got three young, good-looking guys here to share the stage with me, and so we're happy about that, who are all dedicated to the Lord and to the work of the Lord. We're going to talk about Little Light Studios. That is a name that you have perhaps heard before, but maybe not in its most recent incarnation, dare I say. They're doing some good things and added some new men and material, dare I say. Let me get the names here. Scott Meyer, who's been here many, many times. I guess you like Scott or Scotty?
You know, Scotty works well. That's what most people call me, so.
Yeah, Scotty keeps you young. You know, when you
right.
get
that's
Scott,
right.
that's when you get grandkids.
Yeah.
We got Scotty Meyer. We got Mikey Jenny. Mikey Jenny sounds like the name of a football player. Yeah, no, yeah. Quarterback Mikey Jenny.
That name keeps me young as well, you know.
And let's see. Keith Detwieler.
Yes.
Yeah, Detwieler. I know a Detwieler. I'm trying to think. Anyway, three good guys who've got a lot to say, and we're very, very excited about what they have to say. And I think before we go into our music, I want to just jump in, because I'm kind of excited about this ministry and what you guys are doing. So before we go to music, let's get a little background, because you're kind of the original guy, Scotty. You know, you're the original guy. Give me just a little flavor. Where are you from? How this whole Little Light thing got started, because you were on a whole other track and the Lord kind of snatched you and brought you into something else. So give me the sort of Reader's Digest version of that.
Sure.
Then we'll go to Mikey and Keith.
So I grew up in a little town of Paradise, California. Mm-hmm. Maybe some of you have heard of this place called Paradise, maybe not, but it's a very like nice little small town in Northern California. Mm-hmm. I grew up with a fascination in film. My parents had a little 8mm film camera, so brother and I used to make little stories with our neighborhood kids. When I got to college, took film studies in college, and ended up in Los Angeles working in the film and television industry for a number of years, mm-hmm. but really lost all connection to my roots as an Adventist. I grew up and went through all Adventist schools, even through college, and mm-hmm. Just fell into the world,
yeah.
and God sent the right people at the right time, pulled me out of that, and I started praying, God, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to use my gifts and talents for you?
Mm-hmm.
And we started making little documentaries on various different subjects, and here we are today.
Yeah, yeah. So you did the, quote, Adventist thing all the way through school.
I did.
Yeah.
You know, I was a good Adventist,
yes.
so to say, you
yeah.
know, a little,
yeah.
little angel from paradise. But like most of our youth, you know, that go away from the church, I definitely just lost interest in,
mm-hmm.
and it wasn't that I disbelieved it, I just didn't have the heart for it.
Mm-hmm.
And so coming back with a new set of eyes, I have a real passion for that demographic,
yeah.
probably because that was my exit.
Mm-hmm.
And so we like, you know, creating content and aiming at them, because this church has so many beautiful truths.
Mm-hmm.
How can we present it to our youth so that they don't walk away?
Yeah.
That's kind of the purpose of Little Light.
Yeah. And when Little Light started, one of the things I recall that it was really kind of had its sights on being an evangelistic arm, sort of outreach. but the Lord has sort of changed. You know, the Lord doesn't waste anything.
Yeah.
He uses our experiences to become part of our resume, mm-hmm. which you well know. So since you saw how you can be in the Adventist bubble mm-hmm. and not be Adventist or not even be Christian,
right.
you're just doing the Adventist thing.
That's right.
One of the burdens of Little Right as it has evolved is to go back and sort of give those who may be in that same path some stability and some roots. And I think that's a great, great evolution of the ministry.
That's right. That's
yeah,
right.
really do. Mikey, did you grow up in a Christian home?
I did. It was more Baptist-y. You know, my parents were raised in Christian schools all their life, but mm-hmm. when I grew up, it just seemed like, I was into the youth and stuff like that, but when I got to like 12 and 13, I thought, this is like holding me back, and I saw MTV and it looked so fun, and you know, I was kind of drawn to that and wanted to do my own thing, you know, and
mm-hmm.
so I did that for a while and it didn't really, didn't get me anywhere, so, you know, a lot of the party life and trying to escape through drugs and alcohol, but when I reached rock bottom, you know, I really had to cry out to God, and my cousin inspired me to just read his word and stop judging God by all the hypocrites that represent him or whatever. And so when I really started reading his word for myself, that's when it pricked my heart. And I started to pray for things I needed and saw God answer supernaturally in ways that he knew I needed to see. And I couldn't keep running from him, you know, so I realized at that point I was running, and it wasn't the questions of whether he was there anymore. It was just me running. So I felt like I wasn't good enough to be a Christian. But one night, alone in my house, God revealed himself to me in a way that was just so personal to me. And I knew it was him, that I knew he was meeting me where I was, that I wasn't going to have to clean myself up to get to him. And that night I accepted him in. And from there, it was a slow growing process. There was probably 8 years where I didn't look like a Christian, you know, but I had at least a belief in him, and I prayed to him and had a personal relationship. But over time, God started like giving me these real kind of instantaneous eye-opening things about the times we're living in that kind of mm-hmm. made me get more serious. And so I came across Little Light's material, and that was reassuring some of the things that God was showing me about agendas in Hollywood and things like that. Mm-hmm. And that's what got me really interested in their ministry and to want to spread this message to the younger generation out here.
Now, you're from where originally?
I was born in North Carolina. I'm an Army brat, so all over, but Chattanooga, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I heard the little lilt, so I knew you weren't native Californian.
Yeah, no.
It occurred to me. So you were, can you class yourself really as a seeker, as yeah. though, you know, even though you didn't quite know what it was you're looking for,
exactly.
you were seeking?
Yeah, I would never say I was an atheist. I was agnostic. Mm-hmm. Even as an elementary school, I would go to the library and I'd get the paranormal books about ghosts and aliens, and I was just so intrigued by that. Like, what is this? Is it real? You know, is it?
Mm-hmm.
And I really wanted to know what that was, you know, and God's showed me a lot of what that really is now and given me those answers, and I believe the answers are in the Bible.
Praise the Lord. And isn't it interesting, Mikey, that God will meet you where you are.
Amen.
On the road that you're on. You've come together in ministry, but your paths are totally different. You know, you did the straight up Adventist thing, and then you came from a whole different kind of deal, but God met you both at your point of need and then began to walk you into where he wanted you to go. You said to me, as we were talking before, that you weren't like broken down at rock bottom when God called you. You were actually doing pretty good.
Yeah, I was. I had a clothing line. It was called Execute Clothing, and I'd print t-shirts with, they just looked like rock and roll t-shirts, you know, and a lot of people were starting to, I had a lot of bands and models from all over the world wearing them and giving me free pictures of them wearing them and stuff. And so I had all the promotion, and I actually went homeless on the road to promote this thing, and for a year did that, and that's how it got the name. And started doing a rap project with a guy, and we were on our way to move to California because everything seemed like it was falling in place. I mean,
mm-hmm.
some bigger names in the rap industry were, you know, giving us attention, and we were getting endorsements and things like that. And So God kind of got me to the point where I'm like in California having a music video shot by a guy who worked for MTV, and he got all these models and all the film crew, and it's just like, wow, this is real. And that's when God was like, look how close you are. You can have this, but this isn't what I have for your life. So he let me make the decision. It wasn't like, you're my last resort, God. It was like, yeah, I'm laying it all down for you, just like the fishermen dropped their nets and followed him, you know?
There's something to be said for that. It is one thing to come to God when you have no other options.
Yeah.
You're homeless, you're living in your car, that kind of thing. It's another thing when things are going pretty good. And at that point, God says, knock, 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 hello.
Yeah,
I want you to go here and do something totally different.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you did so. Keith. Now, it's funny, each as we move along, each leap of faith is a little stronger, because Keith really did a leap of faith. When we were talking, you started talking about family and whatnot. Mm. Born where, Keith?
Actually born in Southern California.
Uh-huh, California guy.
Yeah, around Riverside.
Okay, know that area. A Christian family?
Yeah, basically raised in the Adventist church.
Okay.
My mom was maybe Baptist for a little bit of time when my parents got married, but you know, I never knew anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Got to about 14, my parents left the church. Reason being, a silly reason, my dad had an argument with the pastor over who was going to do special music, and everybody parted ways, and yeah, we never came back for like 7 years.
Mm.
So 14 to 21, which are pretty formative years, I think,
yes,
for a person, no church at all. I mean, we just didn't go anywhere. And that's where I want to say a lot of the influence of the world came into our family, my life in particular. And I just soaked up all kinds of stuff on TV and movies and, you know, a little bit of video games. But then about 21, I had been in school for a couple of years, went to Missouri Western State University, studying chemistry. Met a girl, and she was Christian, which I thought was odd at a public university, because most of the girls I talked to were talking about partying, smoking, drinking, whatever. And this girl happened to be reading her Bible, and I was like, And she challenged me with a couple things. One of them was, most people don't know what they believe or why they believe it. And it got me to thinking, what do I believe and why do I believe it? You know, if I would say I'm an Adventist, that's the one thing I would identify with. Why would I say that? What are those things that that make me so, and where are they in the Bible? So I really started studying a lot for myself, and then challenging her with some of the things that I was studying. And so eventually we got married, had children, and I came across this material online, Facebook of all things. Somebody, a friend of mine, his nephew posted a video, and I watched it. I watched more of it. It was of Scotty, and I thought, that makes a lot of sense. You know, a lot of people, you know, they have a hard time because their parents tell them, don't do this. Well, why? You know, a lot of times the why isn't there. And I think that's one thing that Little Light provides, is the why.
Why? Let me ask you a question, Keith. When you got married, were you doing the church thing at all? You said she was a Christian.
Yes.
And
so,
you had certainly some Christian background. Were you moving towards the Lord, kind of in a holding pattern?
Definitely. No, I was definitely moving toward the Lord. In fact, it was interesting because I recognized that, and I prayed that he would remove this girl out of my life if she was going to be a distraction. And he didn't. In fact, he confirmed that she wasn't going to be a distraction. And we got married, and, you know, everything, that side is history. You know, we had four kids, and here we are today. But at one point, yeah, I made a decision because I felt like God was calling me to ministry. I applied to Amazing Facts, kind of fell through. The job just kind of dissolved, and I was like, okay, well.
Now, you're working doing what at this point in time?
Agricultural chemistry.
Okay.
Yeah, I worked for a company that was owned by Land O'Lakes.
And okay, so you got a solid job. It's not like you're out looking for something to do.
Yeah, solid job, benefits, you know, that whole thing. And it's a pretty good company, and, you know, I guess I could have moved up if I played my cards right. Probably would have been better if I went back to school and got my master's, but.
Yeah, but you're a chemist. I mean, there's not growing on trees. You know, that's Yeah, it's fairly impressive.
It was all right. It was all right. So, yeah, but I felt a strong call to ministry from a young age, actually. About 11. Mm-hmm. And I never really did anything with it. My parents encouraged me to be a doctor. So when I was in school, I was really pre-med. Mm-hmm. That's why I went the chemistry route. Mm-hmm. And then, I seen this opportunity come around and thought, you know, maybe this is it for ministry. Maybe this is what God is calling me to do. And I asked him, you know, if that's what he wanted me to do, he had to sell my house. And he did. Mm-hmm. I mean, I literally only talked about selling my house to one person 6 months prior. I prayed that prayer, and 2 weeks later, I got a phone call from this lady's daughter. And it was somebody I would never really talk to that about. Mm-hmm. She's like, hey, I heard you're selling your house. I said, yeah. She's like, I want to come look at it. And the whole process happened so fast. It was unbelievable. Mm-hmm. I mean, just within a matter of a couple of months, everything was wrapped up and done.
Wow.
But then God threw a little hiccup in. We had our fourth child, and we had moved in with my mother-in-law. And, you know, it was like hard to find a place in California. It's really expensive. And when you just quit your job, you don't have all these finances available at your disposal. But by the next year, we moved. And it was tricky because ministry's tough. I mean, it's not always easy, and especially financially. Mm-hmm. I remember the day that Brandon called me, and he said, I think you should know before you move out here, nobody got paid this month. It's like, I'd already quit my job. I was moving my family.
Oh, leave.
And it was like, what do I do? And I talked to my wife about it, and I said, you know what, if I don't do it, I'll never do it. Because the devil always puts something in your way to prevent you.
Sure.
And so we did it. We talked about it, we prayed about it, and we said, you know what, this, we already have the evidence. God has already answered, so let's go. It can't be like that every month.
So this is wife and four kids now?
Four kids.
Okay.
Yeah, so we moved to Paradise and started working, and I started learning about what these guys do and just trying to be the helping hands where they needed to be helped. Mm-hmm. And so now here I am.
Yeah, so, and you bring a whole different set of, a whole different skill set. Because this is technically, or basically, a media ministry, and you're a chemist. Not the tightest of fits, you know.
Not exactly.
Yeah, but you said something to me, Scotty, which is something we do here at 3ABN. You are much more impressed with the feel and the spiritual DNA than necessarily the skill set. Because you can teach stuff, but the love for God has to kind of be there already.
I'm more attracted to someone's heart or the reason why they want to get involved than I am their skill set. Anyone can be taught something. Mm-hmm. It's really difficult to teach somebody the right spirit of why they're doing what they're doing. And when these guys called me up, you know, I mean, just as random of things that they were involved in or they do, just in dialoguing with them and listening to them and you know, really just praying about it. I mean, like Keith, you know, on our end, we like to ask God very difficult questions. And one of the questions that I asked for Keith, actually, when he came, because we do the same thing on our end, God, if you want us to work with this guy, you know, he's got a family of four kids. I need to know I can provide for him. Mm-hmm. So I said, I want his whole income to show up in my mailbox. That month, his entire amount showed up in a check from a random foundation. Whoa. Never heard of them before. Uh-huh. So, you know, these kind of confirmations to me doesn't matter what kind of skill set they have. If God wants them to work with us, there's a reason for that.
Amen and amen. Now, before we get into hardcore what Little Light is about at this point in time, we want to go to music, but I'm so impressed because Keith and Mikey both came to you watching your stuff. You know, I mean, it was thing that you had produced that they were able to get a hold of, and that did it for you. Is that so, Mikey?
Yeah.
Keith?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. So you got two converts.
I got two.
Yeah. Two proselytes. Yeah, you got right off. Right
I got
off,
two
right
pieces
off
of fruit.
The bat. Yeah. Two believers. And you were impressed with what you saw, Mikey.
Yes. Yeah. God it opened my eyes in a big way. I heard in church them trying to, you know, bash this book or that movie, and I was like, this is kid stuff, you know. To me, I couldn't see it. I had blinders on. Mm-hmm. But God had opened my eyes, and I was like able to see all this stuff instantly. And right after that, I started doing Bible studies with a guy, and he he saw where I was at, and he was like, I think you'd like these guys, and he gave me some bootleg material of,
it's getting out there.
That's right.
I'm almost sad to give you the news. There's a lot of your stuff out there. That's kind of, it's bootleg.
We have a saying in our ministry. We're putting it on God's tab.
Indeed.
That's what we're doing.
But look where it ended up.
Praise the Lord. You know, Scotty, Mikey, I also want to say Keithy, you know, kind of thing. But the same with you. You saw something that really touched your heart and began to pull on some things that I guess were kind of laying back there from a long time.
Yeah. It was the why.
Yeah. Because you're doing evangelism now, which is that's up front and out front doing the work of the Lord. That's frontline stuff, and we praise the Lord. Yeah. We praise the Lord. How does it make you feel when you look back? I've seen all of that original stuff. It's getting out there, it's reaching, and obviously making changes, you know, in people's lives.
You know, I think when we started the ministry, we didn't think about where it was going to go.
Mm-hmm.
We were creating things that tripped us up, or that we wanted to understand or know, or that we were excited about, sort of seeing the great controversy in our world.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we would make these things in our basement and make these things in, you know, sometimes people would ask to come over to our studio and take a look at it, and they'd be like, oh, we thought you guys were a little bigger. And you know, I'm humbled, mm-hmm. really, honestly, mm-hmm. because when I look back over my life, I don't deserve any of anything. Mm-hmm. And God has allowed me to have a tiny little voice in this war that is around us.
Mm-hmm.
And I just feel honored to be doing what I'm doing. And now that doesn't mean everything is cherries and pie.
Oh, agree. I understand.
I've never cried more tears. I've never had more pain. I've never been more discouraged, depressed. I mean, ministry work is hard.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sometimes what people don't see.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's why it's important to pray for those that are out there ministering and creating things. You know, we make videos that share information, trying to point people back to the Bible. And that there's a whole world that doesn't want us to do that. So.
Precisely. Yeah. And an unseen world that doesn't want you to do it either. Mm. Want to go to our music. Then when we come back, I want you, Scotty in particular, to sort of give me an overview of what the original focus of the ministry was and how you've kind of, I don't want to say morphed, evolved into a more inward focus, a more spiritual uplift focus, which is sorely needed by a large segment of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Our music today is coming to us from Paul Kreitzel. He is a good friend of the ministry, came in some time ago, and he is going to be singing Be Still and Know.
Be still. breast. Listen to the rhythm of his unfailing heart love, beating for his little ones, calling each of us to come. Be still.
Amen and amen. Thank you so much, Paul Kreitzel. Be still and know. I'm here with Scotty Meyer, Speaker Director of Little Light Ministries, Mikey Jenny, who is graphics and editing of Little Light Studios, and the evangelist and speaker is Keith Detwieler. Gentlemen, again, good to have you here. Scotty, I want you to give me sort of a, when Little Light was launched, what the focus was and how that has kind of evolved and how the Lord has kind of led you into a, not a totally different path, but certainly a nuanced change into what you were doing originally.
Like we talked about a little bit earlier, I think the focus for us in the very beginning was seeing the great controversy in our world, and that was eye-opening to us. So as we were looking over entertainment and these various things and seeing how, I mean, there's just this common thread through a lot of films that just, that it, there's no other way to explain it other than there's a spiritual warfare going on around us. And we kept going, we're gonna reach the world with this. We're gonna go to the unchurched and they're gonna see that there's a real war going on. But then God kept sending us to these very conservative churches where we kept shaking our heads going, well, we're supposed to go to the world, but why would you keep going to the Adventist churches? And then it really dawned on us that God has a special purpose for our church. And as our ministry has gone down the path, we've learned a lot, a lot since the beginning. And, you know, we got really good at pointing out what the problem was. But then as our ministry's kind of morphed, we've said, you know what really the big problem is not understanding the solution. And the solution is finding truth in the Word of God.
Amen.
And so as we began to kind of change, we said, you know, how can we inspire this young generation to get back into the Word of God? How can we make the beautiful truths that have been here for thousands of years, that have been gifted to our Adventist church, how can we present them in a creative manner and give them to this younger generation that they'll take hold of them and sink them deep in their heart? So I think I love creativity. I love finding, you know, ways that we can add unique ways to approach this subject. But truly, our end goal is how do you get to fall in love with the God of the Bible?
Amen. Amen. Well said. Do you remember some of the titles of some of that original video material that we all who have consumed it are so familiar with, just for our audience?
We've made a lot of videos analyzing different subject matters that Hollywood has put out. So we made one on cartoons called The Magic Kingdom. We made one called The Replacement Gods. Superhero movies are notoriously, you know, spiritualistic in their nature. They're always about these end of the world scenarios where there's this hero that's gonna save humanity. I mean, that's very close to what the Bible is. So we called it The Replacement Gods because what they're really doing is they're taking the same concepts of God and replacing them. And then as we started doing that, people would ask about, you know, oh, my kid plays hours and hours of video games. So we started a video game series called Controller, which, you know, that's what kids play with is a controller to play the video game. But what's actually controlling you? Is it you controlling the video game or the video game controlling you? So that series really took off on that. And then we've kind of split off on different topics from there. We like documentaries, so most of our projects are in that format of documentaries. And we've now moved into a lot of short form things that we've put out on YouTube and social media.
Mikey, do you recall what it was in particular that sort of arrested you and attracted you to Little Light?
Well, like I said, it was like a time in my life when I was just, the scales fell off, so it was like perfect timing. If I would have seen this stuff 5 years before that, I would have probably never watched it again, you know, right? So God's got a perfect timing, you know, and it was Gnostic Gospels, the whole Battlefield Hollywood and the Magic Kingdom, and yeah, I was, my eyes were like able to see it, so when they were showing it, I could see it real clearly.
Yeah, yeah, I've watched Magic Kingdom any number of times with my grandson, just seen it. Anything particular jumped out at you when you were watching, Keith?
I would say probably Gnostic Gospels as well. So I was pretty well versed in my Hollywood library. So when I seen those things, it was like immediate recognition of what's going on once once it was broken down. And then later the replacement gods.
So Scotty, a lot of even Adventist young people don't watch, certainly with a critical eye, and some of them don't know what they're consuming. Can those materials still be gotten?
They can.
Okay.
You can find them on our website, littlelightstudios.tv. We've put out a lot of things onto YouTube for free, so you can see a lot of like smaller versions of that same sort of thing that kind of keeps up with the current things that are out. So there's many ways that you can find them.
Okay, we've got some contact information coming a little later, and we'll let them know where they can get that. One of the things that I see here that is part of your growth are video Bible studies. Is a project geared towards reaching the younger generation. And I'm so glad that you guys are still young enough to have a burden for the young people and really have locked down on. There are other groups in the church that are trying to minister to the church. You are another brick in that wall. So walk us through what that is all about and what it seeks to do.
Sure. The Video Bible Study Series is blending video with actual print Bible studies. So it was designed to give a 5-minute video that is very, you know, edited together with graphics and kind of deals with the topic. So we kind of bounced off of the idea of, can we teach this truth in 5 minutes or less? And so in 5 minutes or less, can we show you things like why do we need a law? You know, why does God allow pain and suffering? These are some of the topics that we deal with. And then we use YouTube as our main delivery of those. And we put a link in there where people can actually download a Bible study that's designed very well, like a magazine. It has a lot of design elements to it, so it's very pleasing for the younger generation. And if they want to look more into the topic, they can see where we got that idea from the Bible. So it's really meant to be used in a group setting. Watch the video, discuss it, and then do the Bible study to further your understanding.
Like that. Have you found, for older, more settled Christians, Adventists per se, the kinds of things that trouble them are not necessarily the kinds of things that their children are wrestling with and are facing. For the older crowd, if I can use that term, which day is the correct day? Those classic things, State of the Dead, Sabbath, those kinds of things. It seems as though that younger people are dealing with much more rubber meets the road kinds of stuff, you know? How do I stay away from drugs? How do I not allow myself to get sucked into a lot of stuff? So is your ministry trying to address those kinds of things in particular, those things that really young people face on high school campuses, on college campuses, in the workplace, once getting out of school? And
absolutely.
I guess I can put that to Keith because you're the evangelist.
So, well, I'm just, Scotty and I both speak, so we're both out speaking to people. So the series is a mixture, and we call it a series because we've done season one and we're working on season two. The idea is that these will keep going. And what we did is we took a mixture of, you know, what people would call doctrinal topics, and we mixed them in with non-doctrinal topics. Not that they're not biblical topics, but for example, talking about what is Christian humility. You know, we live in a world that's very self-absorbed and very self-centered. So what does it look like to be humble from the Bible? So we're tackling those kind of topics. In the future, we're looking at things like sexuality and depression and, of course, drugs and, yeah, just the rubber meets the road stuff like you're talking about that people are grappling with. I think a lot of them have grown up with hearing maybe the more traditional stuff over and over. So it seems like, yeah, okay, I get that, I've got that down, but you know, how do I get help in this area I'm struggling with?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what we're working on.
I really, really like that. You touched on something I would want to hear. What does Christian humility look like in this world where everybody's kind of me, I, and I'm getting mine, you get yours best you can.
Mm-hmm.
Does it mean, you know, we have this bully culture. Does it mean just lay down, let folk kind of walk all over me? Or how do I stand up for myself in Jesus' name and try to, you know, support myself in a world that is really antagonistic to those kinds of values? That's great stuff. You had something.
Yeah, I was just going to add to that. Another element that when we were producing these came about was we developed what's called a master guide. And the master guide is designed to help somebody who's never led a small group study
mm-hmm.
lead a small group study.
Mm-hmm.
So all the Bible studies are inside the master guide, and they have little prompts, little sections where they can take notes or make notes, mm-hmm. you know, wide margins, so they know to start with prayer, to end with prayer, those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
And so has the answers filled in, you know, for the questions. So you can really just drive a small group study even if you've never done that before.
The purpose of giving a Bible study is you can't give something that you don't know.
Precisely.
Mm-hmm. So I think it's really awesome. I mean, Mikey has so many stories. This guy's constantly giving Bible studies. I don't think he ever goes home and sleeps, actually. And the stories that, I mean, he has with teaching them, I mean, he's just excited. But it also, you know, makes him know the information. So that's
sure,
why
sure.
we want to encourage this younger generation, too, as well. You know, do the Bible study, but also, you know, if you can and you're willing to, then give it to somebody else then you know, really sinks into you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, spotlight on Mikey now, because I want to move away from the video stuff. The Lord has taken your background, your resume, and folded it into the ministry. Also, you're like the T-shirt guy,
yeah.
And I really think that is cool. You were saying that occurred to you sometime before, but it wasn't, how do you make this real? How do you make, you know, T-shirts? You can sink a lot of money into T-shirts and lose your shirt, literally.
Yep.
You know, but so Mikey comes along and he's got this expertise. Let's walk through how that got sort of folded into or baked into the cake here.
Yeah, I'll tell you, you don't make money having your own clothing line. I did that for a while. I was homeless and I never made any profit at all. Went to models and people trying to talk you down on your selling price. But when you have to pay to have your shirts printed, there's all kinds of stipulations. You got to have at least 100. It's got to be under, you know, you're paying for every color that's involved. So mm-hmm. you're spending a lot of money and not making a lot back. So I got interested in printing T-shirts of my own because I just like the whole art of it. You know, it's like being in a dark room back in the days when you had to do the whole film processing thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's really a lot involved that people don't know about. But they invited me to do one of these Bible studies we're talking about, and I kind of just jokingly said, don't you guys want to start printing T-shirts? And Scotty's like, well, your machine fit right here? And I'm like, yeah, it would. So he had some, I mean, like I said, God timing, you know, just everything mm-hmm. was coming together. And mm-hmm.
But it's neat. Most of the T-shirts that we have been developing are religious in nature.
Mm-hmm.
They're, you know, artistic, and they're conversational pieces.
Mm.
So we've kind of really sprung board off of, you know, you don't have to give a Bible study. You can wear a T-shirt that has the Sabbath written on it, and mm-hmm. somebody asks you, hey, you know, what is that? Or, and so as even simple as a T-shirt can be, it can be a witnessing tool.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we've enjoyed having Mikey, you know, develop some of these things for us.
Yeah. Yeah. Are young people wearing T-shirts? Are they buying into that stuff?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, we're all living, walking billboards for something. You know,
true.
So
mm-hmm.
we want to be aiming people towards Christ. So they look at you. So it's an icebreaker, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's hard to talk about spiritual things to a stranger. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
You spend a lot of time on high school, college campuses, church groups, of and you take that material with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We should have brought some with you here.
Yeah. We should have.
Oh, ye of little T-shirts, you know, kind of thing. But I think that's a great thing. A great thing, and it. First of all, it promotes your brand, but also it promotes what you're talking about salvation-wise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it broadens that kind of thing. So, Mike, you don't do any talking. You're not the speaking guy. You got a great voice, man.
I need a little practice. You know, I'm interested. I'd like to do evangelistic series and stuff like that.
Uh huh. Uh huh. Yeah. If you have the burden, God will give you the gift.
Yeah.
It's coming. I wanted to get to something before our time gets away from us, and that's video mission. That's a whole new sort of wrinkle. Who's going to walk me through that? Scotty?
I'll start it off. Keith can add it. We have a big need for creative video. Mm-hmm. We've always been small, so finances limit us to, you know, there's always kind of a direct link between how creative you can be and the financing. Mm-hmm. And so all of these media ministries are all using, you know, stories of Jesus or stories of the second coming. And we need media to illustrate that. So mm-hmm. what happens? About, you know, Jesus being crucified, a lot of times we're limited to a picture. Mm. But see, kids are used to the hundreds of millions of dollars that Hollywood's putting into their productions. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of times when they see ours that are not quite as, you know, expensive looking or anything, they dismiss the message. Mm. So Video Mission was a Christian stock media website that we developed that pools a lot of creative Christian media ministries that are out there creating really unique and interesting things. Mm-hmm. And it offers it for them to be able to sell it, so they can sell it and recoup some costs back.
Ah.
But then it can be sold on a really low cost mm-hmm. for the people that need it. So as pastors need video clips or pastors need pictures, they can go onto this website and purchase them. So for example, you're doing a series on the sanctuary. Mm-hmm. So we shot a bunch of stuff about the sanctuary and the priest and putting all these things on there. And people need media of that. Mm-hmm. So we can recoup some of those costs back. We can use it in our productions, but then someone from Brazil or someone from Europe or wherever can also put it in their productions and use it as well.
Uh-huh. So you're kind of I'm trying to think the right word, like a middleman or you provide a place where content can be purchased.
That's right.
Like if I was a singer and I wanted a track, I would go to somebody that sells tracks. You do that for video content.
That's right. But then there's also a lot of kids who are really talented with a camera, mm-hmm. but they don't know what to do with it. They don't work for a ministry. Mm-hmm. You know, they got a camera and a skill. So now they can sit at home, create things for pastors to use. If they're mm-hmm. really good at shooting nature things, or mm-hmm. you know, they're really good at using After Effects and creating CG things of various different biblical topics.
Uh-huh.
So
and make some money too.
That's right.
Yeah. So one of the things you do is connect consumer with products so that they have some. That is a really great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because people who are doing evangelism or other kinds of things or just want something for maybe their own consumption, here's a place where you can go get it. Kind of a one-stop kind of deal.
That's right.
Yeah. Keith, you want to weigh in on this?
Well, I think a couple other things that are interesting about the project is, you know, if you think about young people being in school, they spend a lot of money on school these days. I mean, you're very fortunate to get out of school debt-free. And if you think maybe I go to school for film and animation and things like that, and you rack up a $40,000 bill, mm-hmm. and you're going to get married, your spouse has the same thing, and then you want to get a house, and the thing snowballs.
Yeah.
And you think about those people, what options do they have to pay off all that debt? Are they going to be inclined to go into ministry?
Mm.
Probably not, because ministries tend to be strapped financially, can, you know, have a ceiling. And so they're going to look elsewhere. And I think a lot of talented young people are probably going to places like Hollywood because it pays significantly more mm-hmm. to pay off their school debt. And along the way, they're maybe not keeping in touch with their roots and losing their way, you know, from mm-hmm. salvation. So I think it helps with that as well. We created this a bit out of need, because when we're doing these video Bible studies, you think about all the biblical topics we touch, all the things we touch on, mm-hmm. we need to illustrate those. So it's kind of like, well, if we need to illustrate it, we might as well start creating the tools for other people as well, because I'm sure they're having the same problem. Mm-hmm. It's either too expensive or it's not very creative.
Mm.
So we want to solve both and kind of take the iTunes approach. You know, when iTunes started, one of the reasons they started making music so cheap is because a lot of music was being pirated.
Yes.
Even though, oddly enough, most of the people who were pirating the music were the also buying most of the music, but still they were losing a lot of money. So mm-hmm. you make a song 99 cents, that's in my affordability range.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the same for ministries. You know, if a clip is $20-$40 versus $400, it's certainly in my range of affordability.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to give that tool to ministries to help them spread the gospel much faster.
Well done. I have a good friend who worked in the video library at CNN for many years. And they will sell you clips, mm-hmm. you know, and it started about 1,000, mm-hmm. kind of worked their way up. And we're talking 30 seconds. We're not talking mm-hmm. a full minute, you know. And if you've got money to spend, you can have as much as you want. But video pre-done is expensive stuff. So that is a great way to facilitate what pastors may want to do, what evangelists may want to do. That is really, really nice stuff.
We're really just kind of scratching the tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. Our plan that we're working on is to go to Morocco, where a lot of these types of biblical things are shot.
Uh-huh.
And they have all the sets, all the extras, you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And we're partnering with a couple of different organizations to be able to do that.
Nice.
And go and film for about a week, mm-hmm. which is not very not very cheap, as you can imagine. But hopefully we'll get all the B-roll that we need for a certain segment of the Bible, and then we can keep going back and mm-hmm. doing it over and over again until mm-hmm. we just fill up a whole library worth of useful clips for people to do the work. And when I say we're just scratching the surface, this is just video. You think of, there's music, animations. Think of all the slides and pictures that pastors use, you know. It would be awesome if I could have something that looked like it was straight out of the pages of the New Testament mm-hmm. versus a painting or a picture that somebody did that was from the 60s.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So we need to modernize the tools and update them, because the people that we need to reach, you think about a lot of millennials, they have the highest percentage of atheists in that generation mm-hmm. versus the other generations. It's about double.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not going to take a look at your stuff if it doesn't look good.
No, they're sophisticated consumers. They've seen some really high-end video stuff. And if you come in with something weak, and you can pray over it and ask the Lord's blessing on it, but their mind is trained to see something a certain way. And if they're not seeing it, they're going to blow it off, or they won't respect it. And they won't even take time to get to the message. What they're seeing doesn't entice them, so they're not even listening because they've already shut down.
Yeah, they're being inundated with video.
Yeah.
You think about YouTube, I think it's about 1 in every 5 visits on the web is YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
It's the second largest search engine. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're talking about 74-75% of all the internet's traffic now is video.
Yeah.
So we got to reach them where they're at.
Mm-hmm. This is very powerful. You're kind of like, I don't want to say a startup because you've been around for a couple of years, but you are evolving, you are growing, and I'm so glad that you've targeted this audience. The more ways we can target that particular audience in the church, because if we can motivate them to stand for Christ, they become the evangelistic tools. Mm-hmm. So you are de facto evangelizing because you're preparing evangelists to go out and do what they're called to do. So that's praise the Lord for that.
And we're one little piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to link arms with all the other creators in our church. And, you know, there's a lot of talented people, but we're all fragmented. So, mm-hmm. you know, if we can kind of come together and have more of a pool of talent together and mm-hmm. work together in a sort of unified version of trying to reach the world, mm-hmm. I think we could really get some steam ahead of us. So
agreed. Is there, and I was going to ask this question, is there any sort of clearinghouse or agency that brings young, talented startups or groups with vision together so you can network, or do you just have to kind of go out and find people of like mind on your own?
You know, ASI has been around for a very long time, mm-hmm. and they've taken a lot of us younger ministries under their wings and really helped us move along as mm-hmm. well. ASI has been a huge help to our ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And there's another sort of thing that's springing up called Fruition Lab
uh-huh.
that is really a bunch of entrepreneurs together.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes what we don't realize is business is as much of a ministry as ministry.
Yes.
Like the reason why we're getting involved in all these other things is because we have all these messages that we would love to push out there, but it mm-hmm. takes money.
Yes, it
does. So how do we go out and do that? Mm-hmm. We have to create these resources and these things that can help us achieve those goals.
Yeah.
And so I would love to see more cohesiveness in our church mm-hmm. with the business departments and those, you know, people who are creative. And we need to work together and blend together and make these things move forward.
Yeah, yeah. I've had a chance to talk with the guys on the set from Fruition. I like what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
ASI is good, but it's general. It's across many, many platforms. It's almost, you know, any business. But I'm thinking particularly of media, ministry, internet ministry, social media ministry, those kinds of things that are attracting and holding young people in large numbers, you know, coming together and really strengthening themselves by sharing ideas and sharing those kinds of things. I think that's a great thing.
You know, ARTV is really stepping up and trying to link arms with everyone as well, and mm-hmm. they're starting to get all the creators on video conference calls and,
yes.
and
yes.
trying to work us together as well. How can we start to develop things together? And so we're starting to see the group press together, mm-hmm. and I believe that we will see the gospel go into the world when we begin
Amen.
To work together.
In 100 words or less, Scotty, ARTV is?
Adventist Review TV.
Indeed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. A good friend of mine just began working with him, D. Casper.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
D. I was talking with him just the other day. He's yep. excited about that.
Yep. He hangs out with
yeah.
us.
Yeah. Yep. I want to go now to the address role. You've heard some of the things that Little Light is doing, how the Lord is moving this ministry along. They need your prayers. They also need your financial support. Plus, they have some good video materials that they already have that I think can still be bought. the illegal downloads that you can sit your children in front of this stuff, and it's good. It will hold them. It will watch them. We did this with our grands some years ago, and they watched it. They loved it. And in fact, they've watched it several times since then. Should you want to make contact with them, send your financial support. Buy some of their materials. Here's the information that you will need.
Little Light Studios seeks to minister to the unreached and uninvolved young people of this world through Christ-centered and innovative media. If you would like to help them through your prayers and financial support, or if you would like to purchase any of their products, please visit their website, littlelightstudios.tv. That's littlelightstudios.tv. You may also call them at 530-327-9323 or write to them at Little Light Studios, 10676 Adler Court, Apison, Tennessee 37302.
And that is good information. Scotty, we've talked about a number of things that Little Light is doing. You have moved into another area. Tell us a little bit about that, and then I guess we go to Keith to sort of make your pitch, man, because we know you need funds, you know you need support. But we'll start with you, Scotty. Give us a little flavor of what's going on.
We're always looking for ways that we can get involved creatively. We started a new talk show, so check us out on YouTube. Mm-hmm. That's where we're putting a lot of energy and content right now.
Mm. What's it addressing?
It addresses a lot of millennial topics, depression, sexuality. Uh-huh. I mean, there's some very real things that this generation is struggling with. And so we're trying to fill the gap, put some information out on that, and point people back to the source of truth.
Praise the Lord. Well done. Mr. Evangelist, we know you need some needs. You have some needs. Look into the camera and make your pitch, man.
If you appreciate what Little Light is doing, then we ask that you would kindly pray. Ask God how He would lead in that area. And we have a couple of programs for monthly donors. You can sign up on our website, or you can go to patreon.com/littlelightstudios and help us there. The more content we make, the more people we can reach. So if you want to help us keep doing it on a regular basis, we ask that you would consider what God would have you to do.
As these gentlemen have well said, ministry is taxing. It puts you in the crosshairs of the devil, and yet we know that the Lord is good and great and sustains ministries like Little Light. Our time has fast slipped into eternity. Allow me now in closing to wish you both grace and peace through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We'll see you again soon. Bye-bye, and God bless.